Lord, we just welcome just all that you are this morning. And I just say, God, even in these next few minutes, God, that you just come and grace us with your presence, Lord. And I just ask that the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of who you really are, Jesus, as the king that sits on a throne right now, but is madly in love with his people. I just thank you for your willingness, God, to die for us so that we can be with you forever. And I just say, come, Holy Spirit, and just breathe on this time, that life and hope would be restored. And God, we just thank you, God, in Jesus' name. So this morning, we're going to go for a little journey into the wilderness. And if you have your Bibles or your iPhones or iPads or whatever flavor you might have, let's go to Exodus chapter 3. Hey, Elizabeth and Renee, I might need you guys to do a little demo for me, okay? Michelle's got a couple poise. And so we'll just put them in hand. I'm just going to let you, just to make you aware. And then I just might call on people just for fun. I do have blue suede shoes, so don't step on them. Good. Well, again, welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone that's watching online, and we're just glad you're with us today. So let's go ahead. Exodus chapter 3, and we're just going to read, I think we'll read verses 1 through 6. So my mistake on that. We'll go 1 through 6, and then we'll just kind of unpack this and really just talk about this experience that Moses had in the midst of just his journey and his process of just being about the Father's business. And so it says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire in the midst of a bush. And so he looked, and behold, the bush was not burning with fire, but the bush was burning with fire, but was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Why? The bush does not burn. And so when the Lord saw that Moses had turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And then he said, do not draw near to this place. Take off your sandals, for the place where you stand is holy ground. And so, yeah, I think we'll just stop there. I think we'll, let's go further, because this is good. It says, moreover, the Lord said to me, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face and was afraid to look upon God. And so to me, this whole story, and we'll give a little backstory, and then, so Moses was there was a time where Pharaoh wanted to destroy, and they forgot all the promises because Joseph was this mighty man that had been raised up, and he brought great deliverance to the world. At that time, there was this great famine that hit the land, and Joseph had found himself in prison and worked his way all the way up to the palace. And in that place, he had gained great favor, and actually, he was like the second most powerful person in the world, and God had given him wisdom on how to prepare for this famine that was coming. And so in that, all of the Jacob's sons, they all moved to Egypt during this time. And now many years had passed, 400 years had gone by, and this Pharaoh that had come into power totally had forgot Joseph and all that it had promised. And all of a sudden, he was watching and observing, going, wow, look at all these people. I mean, there's like this reproduction of these Jewish people, these Hebrews. We got to do something about this. And there was this anger and this rage that began to rise up inside him. And he said, we must kill all of the sons. But there was this one son that was stashed and kept in this basket alongside the river, and it ended up in Pharaoh's daughter actually ended up rescuing, and it ended up being Moses. And so Moses was brought into Pharaoh's household actually as one of his own sons. He would have been like third in line for the throne of Pharaoh. And so Moses, God had this plan all along that he was going to bring a deliverer up out of this place, and he was going to bring rescue and bring freedom to his people. And so Moses is raised up in this place, and he's got the best education. He's got this amazing favor. He's got all the resources. He was a mighty warrior. He was a mighty champion. But then the Lord spoke to him about this deliverance and this reality that he wanted to bring to his people, because he found out that he was not actually an Egyptian. He found out he was actually a Hebrew. And this reality rose up inside him, and in his own strength, because he was a mighty warrior, he was a mighty champion, he decided he was going to take things in his own hands to bring deliverance and freedom to the oppressed Jewish people who had been oppressed in slavery. But it was in that place that he saw the taskmaster whipping the back of this Hebrew that he lashed out and actually ended up killing this guy. But it then sent him into the wilderness. And so Moses is 40 years old at this time. I mean, he goes out into the wilderness, and for the next 40 years, he lives in the desert. And so this is where Moses is right now. Now, Moses is 80 years old. Sometimes we think, you know, Moses is 25 years old. Hey, I'm going to do all this stuff now, and I'm going to bring deliverance, and I'm going to go. No, the guy was 80. So all of you that think that you're washed up, guess what? You haven't even begun yet, okay? For real. God just wants us all to really grab a hold of this, that we're never too young to be about the Father's business, okay? And so even if we're in this place, and I believe there's some of us even in this room today that have been in this wilderness season, hey, you know, it's okay. Because the wilderness is always about preparation. The wilderness is always about this place of encounter. I mean, when we look at the stories throughout the Bible, I mean, Moses just being one of them, is that the place of the wilderness, I mean, John the Baptist was the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, making straight the pathway for the Lord. And there's something about this place in the wilderness that it's a place of encounter. It's a place of his presence if we're just paying attention. I mean, David had the same thing. He wandered probably 15, 17 years in the wilderness running from the evil King Saul. Again, it was a place of encounter. It was a place of allowing just mindsets being peeled off. And see, that's what was going on with Moses during this 40 years, that as he was serving his father-in-law, serving in the family business, there was this peeling and humility that came. Mind you, he was a brilliant man. He was educated. He was a warrior. But God wanted to peel these things off. And I don't know that it needed to be 40 years, but in this case, hey, Moses was in the wilderness for 40 years. And so here he is now, just about his father-in-law's business. It wasn't even his own business. It says that he went to the back of the desert, and he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And I find this interesting, because here's where Moses begins this awakening. Here's where Moses begins this amazing encounter, is at the mountain of God. It's there that all of a sudden he's walking and he's tending to sheep and he's in the back of the wilderness. And all of a sudden he catches this glimpse of this little fiery thing. And it's a bush that's on fire. Now, even in this context, in this day and age, it wouldn't have been weird to see fires in the wilderness, because you had other people that would tend to their flocks, and that would, you know, they'd set their campfires. So you would see those things in the nighttime, and even, you know, flashes of lightning would sometimes set these dry bushes on fire. So it wasn't like an uncommon thing to see fire in the wilderness. But there was something about this one that when Moses chose, it says that when Moses chose to turn aside to see that, whoa, look at this bush. When he chose to turn aside, that means when he intentionally made that heart motive, say, you know what, I've got to come a little closer. Don't be shy. And it was then, as he saw, and he began to recognize, he think, wait a minute, this bush is on fire, but it's not even being consumed. And see, I like this, because to me it was like God was waiting for Moses to come. And I believe, this is my thoughts, okay? I have a feeling there was other moments in time during those 40 years where there was bushes that were burning that God wanted to get Moses' attention. Again, this is just me thinking, okay? As I was reading this story and processing, I'm going, did it have to be 40 years? I mean, were there other opportunities where Moses saw the burning bush, but he didn't, he just kind of went, wow, that's a bush that's on fire. And just kept his, you know, about the business. Man, I'm tending sheep. I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. But there was something this day that drew him like, whoa. And when he did, all of a sudden there was this invitation. And he saw the fire, and he saw the bush, and it wasn't being consumed. That's when the Lord spoke, and he called it by name, Moses. Moses, could you imagine that? Like you're just about doing your thing. You know, maybe you're at work and you're on your computer, and all of a sudden, Your computer starts on fire. I mean, wouldn't that be pretty crazy? And it doesn't even get consumed, but it's just blazing, and all of a sudden, you know, the Lord just speaks to you by name, like, whoa! And I believe there's many times, I believe, even in the midst of our own journeys, where there's things that are on fire, and I'm, whatever, it could be people next to us. It could be opportunities, it could be just situations and circumstance. But I believe that it was when Moses made that mindful decision and just said, hey, wow, God knows me by name. I mean, that in itself, it says that angel of the Lord, sometimes the angel of the Lord can actually mean the very manifest presence of God. And see, that's what the fire always represents. When we see the fire throughout the Bible, it's not always judgment and destruction. Actually, the reality is it's more about the marking of God's presence. And that when Moses decided to come a little closer and God spoke to him by name, he kept coming. And the Lord said, whoa, stop right there, Moses. Stop right there. The place where you're standing is holy ground. And there was this awe and wonder that came upon Moses in that time, and he took his shoes off. And part of it is this place of just reverence and awe for the presence of God. You know, because the reality was is that he was a shepherd. And you know what happens when shepherds walk in the wilderness? They get stuff on their shoes. And so he approaches God, and really that's what it is. It's like taking those things off, the dirt of the world, and even just coming to that place where all of a sudden you can come before him because he's a holy God. And I believe that's what was going on, is there was this invitation that God said, all right, this is the time, this is the hour, Moses, and it's not going to be your own strength, because he went to be from one of the most influential people to this, I mean, just kind of downcast, just serving his father-in-law. And I love the fact that from the midst of just this common bush, and it would have been probably most likely in an acacia tree, which still is real common actually within the Middle East. And it's a thorny bush, actually. I mean, it's got pricklies, you know, and just a couple weeks ago I was cutting down a bunch of thorny bushes. I mean, I even had long sleeves on and I still had these nasty cuts all up and down my arm. And, you know, the reality is that it didn't feel good. And you know, even the thorn, and it's interesting because the thorn was actually a branch that didn't produce. I mean, not so much the case of like with a rose, but I'm saying like these bushes, a lot of times it's something that sprouted life but didn't continue, you know, and those little nappy little things. And that's what was on fire, is that God just chose this common bush. And sometimes, you know what, the common bush is the person that's sitting next to us. It can be abrasive. And God just wants to speak even through those that are around us, those just common things like you and I. I mean, God wants to speak to us through our wives. or maybe it's your husband. God just wants to speak to your husband or your children or that person that really just irritates you. God likes to use those common things, those maybe even irritating, pokey things to speak. Did you just say something, honey? I'm kidding. I am kidding. Thanks. Verse 4 says, and so when Moses saw and he turned aside and looked, and God called him from the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And actually a better translation within the Hebrew says, behold me. It was like, it was a call to attention that when Moses said, here I am, behold me. And it was this place where his heart lined up with the reality that God was about to speak to him and he was going to be obedient to whatever he said. I mean, we see the same thing even with Isaiah. Isaiah in chapter 6, it was just like, here I am, Lord, behold me, use me. I will obey you and I will go wherever you say go. And it was that same kind of thing that Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up. This is in chapter 6 of Isaiah. And he saw the Lord high and lifted up. And I mean, the train of the robe filled the temple and there was the majesty and the glory and the fire. And all of a sudden this fire angel comes from heaven and takes this coal and puts it on his mouth. And he's like, whoa, I'm one with unclean lips, and I live in a land with a whole bunch of people with uncleanness. And you know, God wasn't bringing condemnation, even as that hot, fiery coal touched his lips. It was about bringing forth the purity and the awakening sound that would bring revival to a generation, a fire that would come. It was a marking of God's presence in his very life. And this is the exact same thing that was going on with Moses in this time. It was a marking moment. When Moses had done everything he can do in his own strength, that in that humble place that he had spent those years in the wilderness pondering, wow, Lord, I can't believe that these people are still oppressed. And we go on to read even in this chapter, it says, I've heard the cries of my people. And here's the deal, Moses, I'm going to send you. I'm going to take you. Because now it's no longer about you, it's about me. And now that you've encountered my presence and you've heard my voice. And see, that's the reality, is that we all can hear his voice. And he speaks to us in different ways. Again, it may come from people that are around us. It may come from a billboard or a semi-trailer, whatever it might be. God is always speaking. I like to say, are your antennas up and are you tuned into the frequency of the Father's kindness? Because it's always an invitation. The fire is always about invitation into an encounter with the goodness and kindness of God. This is where Moses was. He was about to have an encounter, a radical encounter that would literally change his life. That he would be one that would set captives free. And see, there's people in here today that just need to be set free so that you can do the same thing. That you can be set captives free, that you can bring people to the other side, into the promised land, because that was the whole goal where God wanted to take his people to begin with, was to the promised land, and he was going to use Moses. You see, Moses was an amazing man. I mean, outside of Jesus, he was probably one of the most powerful people that we read about in the scripture. I mean, the grace that was on his life to lead 3 million people in the wilderness. And the unfortunate thing is that the very same mountain where Moses had this encounter, all of a sudden there's the burning bush. And again, it was about this flame of drawing him into this place of intimacy and friendship and kindness to hear the call and the promise and the hope and the destiny that God had set for him. Because he was saved for such a time as this. And we see the same thing even in this nation today with the millions of babies that have died through abortion. There are some that God is rescuing, and I believe they're going to be rescuers, much like Moses. They're being saved for such a time as this. They're being raised up to be a voice, to be a champion that will bring justice on the earth. That the voice, the silent voice and the silent cries of the unborn will be heard in this generation, and abortion will come down to its end. We see the same thing that when Moses was born, we see the same thing that when Jesus was born. The king tried to kill off all the children that were 2 years old and younger. And I believe we're living in such a time right now where deliverance and freedom is about to be released on in this generation in a way that we've never seen before. All we need to do is look at the injustice of the innocent ones being killed each day. I assure you, the enemy's afraid of this generation because there's never been a generation like this. We're a generation that is going to turn aside to embrace the flame that speaks from that place, that burning thing. And it's really about the intimacy. It's really about friendship. It's really about God taking us from glory to glory. And so Moses, even just a few years later, finds himself back at Mount Horeb. The place where he started, God brings this roundabout way. And this is where Moses ascended up to the mountain of the Lord. I mean, there was thunderings and there was lightnings and all of the sound and trumpets. And I mean, all the people freaked out, like, whoa, Moses, you go. And so he did. And he went up the mountain of the Lord and he had this encounter for 40 days in the fire of God. Moses spent time in the fire of God, and it started with the burning bush that wasn't consumed. It was the invitation into intimacy, and God just kept taking him higher and higher and higher, and he wants to take you today higher and higher into those places where his goodness and his kindness and his glory dwells. See, we were made for the fire. We were made to live in the fire and not be consumed because he's the consuming fire. Then when he just burns away those things that don't amount to much anyway, I mean, we're set ablaze. We're set to bring change. We're set to bring life to a generation. And so Moses is up 40 days in this burning flame of God's presence. And it's there that he actually received the Ten Commandments. And those commandments are really the commandments of love. I mean, Jesus just summed them up. He summed up all 10 in 2. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. I mean, really, that's what the commandments were. They weren't meant to be law and duty. They were a reality of God's kindness and God's love being made manifest to the people on the planet. And those laws haven't changed, by the way. I mean, we try to change all kinds of laws. We try to take them out of places where they were put in. But you know what? It doesn't change it. And it won't. Because God's love always prevails. And we're called to be ambassadors of that kind of love. That in the midst of our day, see, and that's where I was thinking, you know, was Moses too busy at other times, even when there was times where God was trying to prompt him and draw him? And we can get caught up in the busyness where we miss those little burning flame moments, those places where God just wants to draw us into his heart, where he wants to call us by name, because he knows us by name. He knows every hair that's on our head. He knows the future and the hope that he has already been laid out for us. And he's awakening a generation with a boldness and a confidence to understand who they are as sons and daughters. I mean, to understand true identity is the key for what God is doing in this day and this hour. And the sooner we get it, the greater victories we're going to have. And he's very patient. He really is. He's been patient for thousands of years. But I believe there's something happening in the spirit right now that's causing this momentum to rise up, that we really are getting a hold of this. That we really are embracing the flame. We're going into those places. You know, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I mean, these are three guys that we see in the book of Daniel. They did not bow down to the false god. They wouldn't do it. And they said, here's the deal. Nebuchadnezzar. That's how they did the VeggieTales, I think, right? Anyway. They wouldn't do it. They wouldn't bow. Because they knew their God. They knew their God. And they weren't going to bow to some engraved image or some carved thing. Or, you know, we see that as, you know, just, it could be anything in our lives these days. Anything that actually gets in the way to true worship to the one that created us for his love and for his friendship. And when we really grab a hold of this, and we'll never bow down and worship another, something happens and shifts. And I really believe that that's what God is doing in the way of an awakening in this time and this hour, is that we're not going to bow down to those lesser things. We're not going to bow down to money. We're not going to bow down to this or that or some American idol. We'll worship the King and the beauty of holiness. And so they wouldn't bow down. So he said, I'm going to throw you in the furnace then. He's like, yeah, well, if we die, we die, whatever. We don't care. We're not bowing down to you. We're not bowing down to your nonsense. We're not bowing down to your false religions. You're not a god. You're just a man like me, created in his image. You were meant to be great in his heart, but you've chosen another path. And they were thrown into the fiery furnace. 7 times he said, turn it up, hotter, hotter, hotter. You know, the enemy always wants to do that. He wants to make it hotter, hotter, hotter. It's then in the midst of the flame that they go in. The King of Glory joins them in the fiery furnace. And the amazing thing is they didn't even smell. I mean, like fire, I should say. They didn't smell like fire. They smelled like Christ because he was with them in the midst of the fire. And he was taken back going, oh my gosh, all my men around the flame just got burned up. But the ones that were actually in the flame, there's one of the, like the Son of God that joined them in the fire. See, that's the reality is that when we get into the fire, the Son of God will join us in the fire. See, that's where Moses said, when he took off his shoes and he laid those things behind, the messes and stresses of life, and he chose to approach the throne of grace, like we can so boldly come because of that reality right there. There was this encounter. And see, there's fires happening all around us. Again, it can be in people. See, that's the reality, is that we can be that dry, ordinary wood, but Christ in us, there's this fire that's inside of us that just draws. See, fire draws. Can you guys grab those poison? Come up here. one on each side. And so we were doing this. We were doing this outreach up in Iron Mountain. Did I get that right, UP people? Upers, don't you know? But we were doing this outreach, and one of our guys could like twirl fire. So we thought, yeah, let's do fire, because fire will just draw people. And so we're in this outdoor amphitheater, and then we talked Renee and another person in, and you guys, we'll twirl fire. And so it's kind of neat, because like these fire poise, which we don't have here today. I should have thought of it. No, we wouldn't have done it anyway. There's this Kevlar. It's like this Kevlar ball that's on the end of it. And you soak it and saturate it actually in fuel. But the amazing thing is that when you light it, the Kevlar ball doesn't get burned up. Only the fuel gets burned up. And so it's similar to that burning bush. You know, it's like, it's the fuel of his presence. It's really about his presence. And see, that's what causes things to burn, and it doesn't get consumed because, so anyway, we have these poison. He's twirling this fire. And I mean, we have got hundreds of people already kind of watching. But as soon as the fire came on stage, I mean, all of a sudden you begin to see all kinds of people begin to draw in. See, fire draws. Fire draws. It brings in a crowd, really. The fire does that. Fire does that. So here's my challenge to you. Just set yourself on fire and let people watch you burn. I mean, that was John Wesley's motto. All I do is I set myself on fire. I spend time in God's presence. I get soaked and saturated in that place. And then Holy Spirit comes and then I just burn, burn, burn. And that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to burn brightly, to truly be the light of the world that just draws. Because as you guys go just start, and so imagine this is fire. So they're twirling this fire, and then my other guy, he's got these fire sticks, and he's throwing it up in the air. They look almost like a what do you call those things? A luau, you know, like all this fire. We had the drums going, we had this whole drum circle thing going. The drums are drawing people in, the fire's just causing, like, wow! And then we just preached the gospel, and a whole bunch of people got saved. And see, that's the beauty of the fire, because it draws. And it gives us opportunity to share good news. And you know, sometimes that good news may be shared in a platform like this, but other times it might be just good news shared with the person that's working next to you. So my challenge to you is this: just dip yourself in the presence of God and just set yourself on fire. Because it really will begin to draw the lost. It really will begin to draw the hurting. It really will begin to draw the broken. You see, we've got a message of hope in us that has to be heard in this day and this hour, regardless of where we're at. If you're in the grocery store, release it. If you're in the workplace, release it. If you're in the parking lot, release it. If you're in this room, release it. See, that's the beauty of the prophetic, and when we really begin to operate and function in God's heart, that's the whole reason the gifts of the Holy Spirit were given to the church. I like how Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 14. Pursue love. So that's the key word there. We've got to pursue love. And it goes back to the simple commandments that Jesus gave. Love God, love people. So pursue love and eagerly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you might prophesy. See, because when we prophesy and when we speak, we create realities. We create realms and atmospheres through our words that literally change and transform the human heart. The same way that God spoke, light, and all of a sudden there was light. You know that God's given us that same kind of thing because we have been created in his image, that our words literally set things into motion. Our words can literally change a situation and a circumstance, that as we release those things with faith, all of a sudden, poof, there's an opening, there's a blasting, and whoa, things just happen. So my challenge to you is just dip yourself in the oil of his presence. And as you just let yourself burn, it'll cause people to turn aside, to come a little bit closer, and to come a little bit closer, and to come a little bit closer. And then you just call them out by name. And that's why I love even prophetic evangelism. When we're in the streets and all of a sudden you approach someone and you've got these just nuggets of God's grace and you begin to, I call it read people's mail. And all of a sudden you're telling them things that they're like, how do you even know this? It's because God knows each person so intimately. And he just wants to set captives free. And how does he do that? Well, through you and me, the same way he did with Moses.
that as he had that simple encounter with a burning bush and he entered into this place of intimacy and he began this journey with God in a fresh new way, not at his own strength, but empowered by the grace and the goodness of a loving Father, finds himself standing in the midst of a fiery, blazing mountaintop, having this experience with God, going, wow, this is awesome. Yeah, that 40 years in the wilderness was worth it just for this right here. And he just said, oh God, I want to see your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. Because Moses had this amazing friendship because he chose to turn aside and approach the flame of God's presence. It set him on this course of intimacy for the rest of his journey, that even as he had set up the tabernacle of worship in the wilderness, it says that fire would come down from heaven and a cloud of smoke as Moses would seek God face to face. That's what I like. God says this, oh, Moses, he's like my friend. I mean, we speak face to face as a friend. And see, that's what God's looking for, his friends. Because in that place, all of a sudden, he begins to share secrets with his friends. And all of a sudden, you get the secrets of heaven and the reality of even the person that's sitting next to you that one moment you didn't have a clue what was going on. All of a sudden, God just whispers the kindness in your ear and you just release it and it sets someone's heart free. It brings them hope. It brings them healing. It brings the joy. It brings honor. It brings grace. It brings love, 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 love. So let's turn aside today. Let's start this journey afresh. Let's start this journey afresh. To be just dipped in his presence, that we can be the burning bushes. A place of encounter. Where hope is really released. Where hope is really restored. God's inviting us to the deeper place. And it is about the love. I mean, it really is. It's all about that. And see, that every time I think about this, it amazes me because he invites us into this encounter to see him as he really is. He changes our heart. And then he goes, now go do likewise. So as we encounter that, well, now we're just called to go love. And love can be seen in so many different ways. It could be a simple smile at the person at the checkout counter. It could be the $50 that you give each month to the Hope Home. It could be that encouraging word that you release over your friends and your coworkers. It could be just bringing your neighbor to church. Right, Claudia? You guys stay up here. You can stop the twirl if you want. I mean, if you want, you can twirl if you want, but the whole point is the fire draws. Actually, Mike and Vicky, why don't you guys come up here? Come up here. And who Mark and Michelle, who's on the prayer teams? Actually, come on up here. We're going to do something. So here's what we're going to do. Is we're just going to prophesy. And we're going to release God's kindness. So just begin to stir up the gift right now that's inside you to see what the Father's seeing. And Lord, I just thank you that It's your goal all along is to bring us into a freshness of encounter. To be in your presence where there's the fullness of joy. And Lord, I thank you even for this time and this season that where it seems like things are really dry, that's when you show up. That's when you bring us into the freshness of just to see you as you really are. I thank you, God. I thank you, Lord. And Charlie, I'm just seeing this picture over you, and it's like, it's a whole new day, and I just saw like the just sun rising up, and I feel like even for you, there's a new sense of hope and a new sense of even like
like meaning to life that God's awakening inside of you. And God just wants you to embrace this new day. It's going to look different than yesterday, so don't focus on yesterday because it's a new day. And I see even just this green life that's swirling around you, and God's bringing you into this place where you're going to just experience and encounter just the freshness of everlasting life that comes from the throne of grace. Jesus loves you, Charlie, with a love that is beyond comprehension. And the reality is that he actually fashioned you for friendship. He made you, Charlie, to be his friend. And he just loves you. I just see his love all over you. And he just wants you to understand that. You're not forgotten. You're not forsaken. But he's right there with you. I just see even just like this book being opened up and you're just like journaling, just like the whole new chapter, the whole new story, because that's what you're entering into. Coming out of the old and into this whole fresh new, the rising of a new day. And so I just bless you in the name of Jesus. All right.
What's your name back there? The lady in the back? Yep, that's you. What's your name? Jennifer. Yeah, God definitely highlighted me to you. So first thing is God says that you are a spiritual warrior. And I just see fire in your heart. And I just see God just shining down on you today. And he just loves you. He just calls you beautiful daughter. And he just loves you so, so much. And he just wants you to see you as he sees you. Just a beautiful, beautiful worshiper. And I just see you dancing in heaven with God. Just in the meadows of heaven. I just see you and God together. And you just have a really special relationship with God. And he just really appreciates that about you. So, yeah.
I just want to highlight Mike and Lynn Byler for just a second, because what took place here today is something the Lord is doing for all of us. So this is for every one of you in this room today. This last week, for me, I was busy in the middle of my work week, and I was talking with someone, and I drove by a truck that had rhubarb leaves in it. And I said to somebody, I can actually taste rhubarb crisp right now. Oh, what I would give for a sample of rhubarb crisp or rhubarb custard right now. I can actually literally taste it. That was like on Tuesday. And I come to church this morning, work in the cafe, and all of a sudden in walks Lynn and Mike Byler, and Lynn has a tray full of rhubarb custard crisp. Now, if you tasted that rhubarb custard crisp, you know how delicious it was. Anybody taste that? It was delicious. But I want to say thank you, Lynn and Mike, for doing that. But how important it is for each one of us to begin to verbalize what you desire. Verbalize what is in your spirit. As the Lord begins to show you your future, and you have a glorious grand future, every last one of you, and it's so important for you to grab a hold of your future. Why? Because that's where you're going. And so the Lord wants you to begin to see it with his eyes and begin to speak those things into existence. For yourself, your family, your children, your career, your finances, your health, this house, the place where you worship, begin to speak what God is showing you in the realm of the Spirit. And believe me, he will deliver. Better than rhubarb crisp. In Jesus' name. If you receive that, raise your hand right now and say, I take that, Jesus. I take that.
Thank you, Lord. The fire was in the rhubarb.
That's awesome. Dennis, I actually have a word for you. I feel like the word I got for you was sleeping giant. I feel like God is bringing you through this time in your life, and you're getting to a point where you're going to arise, and you're just going to, just the gift of prophecy in your life, and you're going to use it just to edify so many people around you. I feel like there's so much inside you that is just going to be released. You have so much goodness that you're just going to bring forth through the gift of prophecy and just build up the members of this church. So I just release that upon you, Dennis. I just bless you in the name of Jesus.
Okay, so I was seeing a word for you. What's your name? Yeah. What is it? Oh, okay. Yeah. Do you need to translate for her? Okay. Okay, yeah. So I was feeling like the Lord is going to be showing himself to you in a very practical way. I feel like the Lord is going to be showing himself to her in a very, like, practical way, and that she's going to be able to know him in, like, a relationship, and it won't just be, like, he's far off, but, like, that he's there with her. And then, yeah. And then I was also feeling like that you're able to like see like what's going on with people, and that you're able to you're very intuitive with people, and that the Lord has actually given you that gift, so then you can pray for people and you can be there for people and see what's going on, and that you can bring encouragement and bring life to people. So yeah. So bless you. Jesus loves you. Yeah.
I'm just sensing that somebody came here today with a deep desire to get closer to God, that you've been trying to get closer and closer, and I keep hearing that somebody's keeping score. And you may not think, you may have messed up a lot in the past, and you're just thinking that God is keeping track of that. He's keeping score. I just want to tell you, if that's you, that God doesn't keep score. You may keep score, but just get rid of that. God does not keep score. He loves you the way you are. The more broken, the more mistakes, the more he loves you. He just wants you to come. So if you have any hesitation about what you've done in the past or all of the mistakes, I'm just, right now, in the name of Jesus, just leave it be. Dump it here. Give it to Jesus and let it go, and just come to him. He's waiting for you. His arms are wide open, and he's torn the scorecard up. And I can attest to you as a horrible golfer that it's great when you tear that scorecard up. So tear it up and just come to him. He's waiting for you. He wants you. He just wants to love you. So let it go.
Stephanie. I just felt God saying that to tell you that he sees you. He sees what you're doing right now, what you've been doing for a while now, all your hard work and efforts and dedication and obedience, and he's really, really proud of you. He never doubt yourself, like from the appearance that you carry to your style to the way that you speak, because he made you just as you are. It was no accident. He has such big plans for you. You're going to be able to speak to others in a way to bridge from where they stand as they are in this world to where he is. You guys are going to connect. You're going to connect those hearts. And that's what he has for you. And you're going to be able to do it in such a unique way, a better way than a lot of other people can do it, because of the uniqueness that you carry. Mm-hmm. And so, he loves you. Yeah. Thanks.
I sense that there's someone either here or even online has a ringing in your ear, and you've had it for some time. A loud ringing, it's a chirping or whatever. There's many people plagued with that. First of all, God wants to heal you in Jesus' name. He wants to clear that up for you. But there's like a ringing, a loudness. And that ringing, the thing about ringing in ears is you can still hear. You can still hear even quietness. And I believe that God is saying that he's wanting to make your keen hearing his voice calming and cutting out all the clamor, all the loudness of the world, and he's calming your hearing. He's giving you keen hearing to hear his voice, to do his will. But so I pray in Jesus' name that that inner ear will be healed in Jesus' name, and that you'll be sensitive. God says, you're called to be sensitive to my hearing, my word. God's given you a beautiful gift of hearing what he hears and sharing what he has in his heart. So God bless whoever that may be today in Jesus' name.
And at the end, you can come up. We're going to have a time for prayer, and it'd be great if you if you feel like the word was for you, for Vicky to pray for you. So,
I have a word for Chris. So, just the first thing I felt is God really wants you to know, Chris, that you're significant in the Lord. That there is a call on your life, and it is significant. The other thing I saw is and heard is that God calls you a strong tower, but specifically, the picture I got was like a lighthouse, just a super, super tall lighthouse, and the light at the top of the lighthouse was really, really bright, and then I just see that there's people around you that need what you have, that they're in a storm, just like the waves around a lighthouse are just really fierce, and there's a lot of rocks and boats. They see the lighthouse to know where they need to go to be safe. And there's people around you that they need to get to a safe place with God. And you're their lighthouse, that you're the way to lead them, that you're the person to lead them to safety with God. Yeah.
Come on. Yes.
Bless you.
Tangi, I'm going to have you stand up. Can you stand up, please? Yeah, it's important you stand up. Because that in the past season, I was just really drawn to your green shirt. God uses that, you know. And what used to entangle you in the past season, I saw you like tangled up, like Steve said, when he got tangled in those vines. That which used to entangle you is now going to be that which breaks through and you spring up. God, that's why I had you stand up, because you are coming, you're rising above. This is your season. And I just see that coming you up and out of all that's being untangled, undone, and you are rising up. And so I decree that over your life. I just see that, and God is cheering you on. She says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you, and you will not get tangled up anymore. Those things have now, you're just going up, 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 and away. So bless you.
Who's got a birthday on July 19th? I just heard July 19th. Anyone?
Significant date?
Yeah, I just heard July 19th. So 7/19. So anyone? Not a problem. Excuse me? Yeah, I feel like someone in the room, but I could totally missed it, because I do that. I'm just trying to hear Lord. And we're all in this practice. And see, everything that's been happening here, we're just practicing hearing his voice. See, because God's got all this good stuff to share. And so that's really the whole motive and whole heart behind this, is that we just want to bring that encouragement and that strength to you. And so can we just all just stand up? Can we do that? Yeah, one more word. Sarah, for you, I saw this bridge. And I feel like that's part of what the Lord is really putting on you, even in this season. You're going to be a bridge to many, to see many come into the goodness of God's love. And God's going to use you as that bridge and that walkway, that pathway that brings people into the reality of how much God loves them. And I also saw, too, just that there's something even fresh coming, even in the realm of worship. And I just see almost like what I was seeing is almost like like I could see these music notes, but I could see them, then the music notes as they were flying like out of your mouth, all of a sudden they would land on the page. And it was almost like the sense of that as you began to sing the song, you would actually write the song. And I just feel like there's just something that's coming on you even in this season. And I see even in the quiet times, there's something even with the dream life that's being awakened fresh and new too. And I just see that what I'm just seeing is just this season of dreaming is coming forth. And I just bless you with that. And I think that you are truly going to be a bridge to see that reality of people coming in to experience the tangible goodness of God. And I thank you, Lord, that you're raising her up to be like David, who released songs that brought deliverance, that brought joy, that brought healing as she ponders the thing and the reality of heaven. And so I just bless her now in the name of Jesus. Just thank you, God.
Sure. So, Dan, could you guys come up, whoever's here with the worship team, for going back into You Are Good? You know, it can be you and Bethany's mind. I want to go back into that song. And, you know, we're just, there. Every God's got a word. He's got, he's speaking over every person here. So there's just some called out this morning, but we're going to have, the teams are going to continue down here. And we're going to continue to, if you want to come up and just get an encouraging word, please come up. Sometimes God does it in public and sometimes he does it in private. There's reasons for both, but it's always good. It's always good. So we have Mike and Lynn, would you mind coming up too and praying for people as well? And if you've got something, anything, other words of knowledge, I want to, you know, if there's any words of knowledge, raise your hand. I'm looking for words of knowledge, not necessarily prophetic words, but a word of knowledge right now. And then and we'll have you. We want to end again going back into God. He is good. You are good. You are good, Daddy. And we're just going to continue to encounter his goodness this morning, right? Come on, he's just so good.
Yeah, God, I just thank you that you're bringing us out of the wilderness place. Yeah. That where we've trusted in our own strength, our own understanding. You say in Proverbs 3 that we should trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not on our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledge him and he'll direct our path. I thank you, God, that you're directing paths today. You're directing our paths today, God, into wide open spaces, opportunities to encounter and embrace your love, Lord. I thank you, God, for the awakening that's coming, God. That as we choose to arise, your glory will shine down on us, bringing hope, bringing healing, bringing strength in our innermost being. That when we try to do it all ourselves, God, we've come to the end of ourselves and we say, God, you take over. Like Moses, like Isaiah, like Peter, like John, like everyone that has said yes to Jesus in this place. I say, God, open the heavens today. And we say, behold, here I am. Use me, send me, take me. But before we go any further, I just feel like I'm supposed to extend an invitation. If you've never said yes to this amazing, uncreated God that created you for friendship and relationship, that you've never responded to the reality of unfailing love that he displayed on the cross for all of mankind, that you could be with him forever, I want to give an opportunity this morning where you can respond to the reality of unfailing love. If that's you today, if you've never said yes to Jesus and you've never responded to the truth of what he finished for you, or if you're one that is, you're just coming back to church for the first time in a long time and God is just wooing you and calling you to just come a little closer to the flame of his burning love and his presence, I want to pray for you today. So you just raise your hand. We just want to pray. If that's you today, if you've never said yes to Jesus, if you've never received just that free gift of salvation that comes from a response, or if he's drawing you near today, if that's you, just stick your hand in. I want to pray with you. If you want to confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, I want to pray for you. Just raise your hand. God, I just thank you for your amazing love. It's so tender, it's so sweet, and it never fails. And God, I just say today that as we come before you, God, that you come flood us with the reality of your salvation. Flood our hearts with the reality of your love that sets our hearts free so that we can soar to the higher places. God, remove those chains, those hindrances. Open prison gates, God, that we can walk out into that freedom that you provided for us that day on Calvary. God, I say release hope. Release hope today, God.
as we come up out of the wilderness, leaning on our beloved, we're consumed by a most vehement flame that many waters cannot quench this kind of love or ever put it out. God, I thank you that it's a season of encounter where we will hear your voice and we will choose to just draw near. I thank you, God, that you are good. You are good. I declare your goodness this morning, God. You are good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's just make this our anthem today. Let us join in with the reality of the song that's in heaven as we proclaim the goodness of our Father in heaven. Let's make this a prayer. He's good. You are good. Word. God loves you so much. And he's got something to share with you, something to say to you. You're not overlooked. You're not forsaken. Let his goodness just wash over you.
Good God, we thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you.